Mr. Ains, we're here to start you off with 11.2, which looks at inference for relationships. And we have three objectives that we're going to be covering in this video. The first objective deals with finding expected counts and looking at contributions to the chi-squared statistic, which we've dealt with. You can also see it looks at the conditional distributions, which is something that is kind of a throwback. We're going to look at the conditions for performing a chi-squared test. So that is the random sample, the large sample, and independence conditions. And then lastly, we're going to perform a chi-square test for homogeneity. That's a new test. So in this lesson, there's two new tests. In this video, we're only going to focus on homogeneity right now. So let's start by looking at the difference between 11.1 and 11.2. In 11.1, we had the chi-square test, for goodness of it, which looked at the M&M activity. We had a hypothesized distribution of the colors of M&Ms, and we wanted to see what we observed, how did it relate to what we were told to expect. Now, the chi-square test for homogeneity is this video. And in this one, we have a single categorical variable, and we want to know, does it have the same distribution in multiple populations? So let's think about organizing it like a table. You have a single categorical variable, and you're trying to see, does it have the same distribution across population 1, population 2, population 3? And that's where we're going with chi-square test for homogeneity. Back in chapter 10, we looked at two sample Z procedures, which allowed us to compare the proportions of two populations together with each other. Now, what if we want to compare more than two populations? And what if we want to compare the distributions of one categorical variable across several populations? And in that case, we need a new statistical test. And we're going to use a two-way table to help us organize that. That statistical test we're going to look at in this video is called a chi-square test for homogeneity. And what that does is we look at the distribution of a categorical variable to see if it's the same across several populations. And one thing is the procedures are the same, but we really want to know what's the difference, because when you read a prompt, you have to be able to tell me what's the difference. So, you know, how is this different from a chi-square test for goodness of fit? And if we're looking at it, a chi-square test for goodness of fit, what it does is we are looking at our hypotheses on a single categorical variable. In other words, we really think of it this way, is you're looking at what you observe from a sample to a population, one population in this case. And we're trying to see, does it fit what you were expecting? So does what you observe fit what was expected with that categorical variable in that one population? For homogeneity, we are going to look at a categorical variable across several populations. So let's just keep that in mind before we begin this. Let's start by looking at conditional distributions and comparing them. Market researchers suspect that background music may affect the mood and buying behavior of customers. One study in a supermarket compared three randomly assigned treatments, no music, French accordion music, and Italian string music. Under each condition, the researchers recorded the number of bottles of French wine, Italian wine, and other wine purchased. Here's a table that summarizes the data, and we have parts A, B, and C for us to answer here. Now, part A says calculate the conditional distribution in proportions of the type of wine for each treatment. So let's keep in mind what they're saying. And so let's highlight a couple things. First of all, background music. That's key. There's three different types of background music that we're looking at. Also, we're looking at the buying behavior of the customers. So really, let me focus on the definition for homogeneity. And that we have right here in gray. We can see it's determined whether the distribution of a categorical variable is the same across multiple populations or treatments. So really, I have to figure out what's my categorical variable and what is my treatment. Maybe conditional probability will help me. So let's think about it this way. Based off what's being told to us here, I can think of this problem as saying, hey, what is the distribution of wine sold given that a certain type of music is playing? And that's really what they're asking here. Hey, what's the distribution of wine being sold given that a certain type of music is playing? Well, that tells me that the distribution of wine sold, well, that's the buying behavior of customers. The type of music, that's the background music of customers. And that helps me, because what happens is I can see that the distribution of wine is my categorical variable. The distribution of wine sold. So the distribution of wine sold is my categorical variable. The type of music is, you know, population or treatment. In this case, we have right here. That's where we're going to have the type of music. So we can see what's going on in this two-way table. So now let's answer questions A, B, and C. So let's look at part A more. And it says, calculate the conditional distributions when no music was playing with the distribution of wine purchases. So we're really being asked to find the distribution of wine given that no music was playing. So we can think of it as given that probabilities. And if I do that, I can look at it and go, well, no music playing has a total of 84. So if I think of it that way, French wine, 30 of that 84. Italian wine, we had 11 of that 84. Other wine was 43 of that 84. And so this is kind of the idea of conditional probability, which means that when French accordion music was playing, the distribution of wine purchases was. Well, again, now we're looking at the distribution of wine still, but we're changing it to French music playing. And so in that case, what happens? Well, now my total is no longer 84, my total is 75. So when French accordion music was playing, 39 of the 75 were French. One of the 75 was Italian, and 35 of the 75 was other. And so we're really looking at conditional probability of how does music affect the wine being sold. And so I could look at the Italian music as well. When Italian string music was playing, so now my total, in this case, gets shifted over here back to, well, this one also happens to be 84. And we could do 30 over 84, 19 over 84, and 35 over 84. And so we can look at the different conditional distributions of these using this two-way table, and we have the percentage breakdown. Now let's look at part B. So parts B and C go together. Part B asks us to look at graphs of our distributions that we did in part A, and so those are done for you over here to the side. And we need to compare these and figure out what can we determine from it, and that's where part C comes into play. And we're going to use comparative words. We're going to give evidence to support those words. And so when I look at these, I see a variety of heights. I can see some heights change based off of what music is playing there. So let's kind of talk about it here. Is the type of wine customers buy, it seems to differ considerably based off the music being played. Now, if I look at Italian wine was very, very low when you had French accordion music playing. You can see that in that middle graph. However, when Italian string music was playing, that's the graph closest to me, it was very high. And I'm not just saying it was very low or very high, I'm giving evidence with the percentages, the 1.3% for very low and the 22.6% for when it was Italian music, even when no music was playing. Now, French wine does appear to be the most popular in this market. It is selling well under all three of the conditions that we're looking at, but most notably, it is better when French music is playing. Now, for all three music treatments, the percent of other wine was pretty consistent. I mean, look at the heights of other wine. It didn't quite matter what was playing, it was still consistent across the board. So this is comparing what we found in our table. Still have yet to look at that chi-squared statistic though. So there's a problem with my answer in part C, and is that as I have no measure of confidence in my conclusion with the statistics. And that's a problem overall with multiple comparisons. So we need to look at a statistical method that allows us to address that problem. And really there's two parts that we're going to use to address that problem. The first is to calculate an overall test statistic. We want to perform an overall test to see if there's good evidence of any difference among the parameters we're trying to compare. The second part, really crucial to be able to analyze your results, do a follow-up analysis, which really looks at the contributors. Which of those contribute the most to the chi-squared statistic? And we looked at that in 11.1, and we're going to continue to look at that because that gives us more in-depth analysis. Now, overall, when we're dealing with a chi-squared test, we're looking at the statistic, we have our null and our alternative. Our null says, hey, there is no difference in the distribution of the categorical variable among the populations of interest or the treatments of interest. The alternative says, you know what, there is a difference in the distribution of the categorical variable across the populations of treatments. So the null says there is no difference. The alternative says, hey, there is a difference. And we want to compare the observed counts in our two-way table with the counts we would expect if the null were true. Well, how do we find the counts that we would expect if the null were true in this case? So finding the expected counts is not too difficult, but we do need to keep in mind the null hypothesis with the wine and music experiment, which says that there is no difference in the wine being purchased based off the music being played in the background. And we have to assume that null is true. So how do you find the expected counts? And what we're going to do is we're going to use the totals. So you can see those highlighted down there. And in this case, if we look at those totals, and let's look at French, it had 99 total bottles of French wine being sold out of 243 altogether sales of wine. And then what happens is that proportion, if the type of music had no effect, that proportion would be constant across the board. And that's what this is telling you. Hey, if there was no effect on the music being played with the wine being purchased, then that proportion, 0.407, that would be the same across all the different conditions. And that's what we're going to use. So you can see we're going to use these totals to create it. Now, to put it in perspective, something you might be familiar with is, if let's say you want to get a 95% average in the class. Well, you can do get a 90% on a test, a 100% on a test, a 91 on a test, a 99 on a test, and so on. Or you can get a 95% on all the tests, and it's still going to work out the same. And that's really what you're doing here, is you're taking that total proportion, that total probability, and you are going to say that it has to be that across the board. And we're going to look at that with this next part. So let's apply that understanding to find all of our expected counts. And really, we're going to do some filling in, but I want us to understand the general idea. We're going to look at the expected counts of French wine being sold under each condition, each treatment. And really, what we're looking at is that there were 99 out of 243 total bottles sold that were French. And under the different conditions, the music being played, the treatment, there was 84 for none, there was 75 for French, and there was 84 for Italian. That's where I'm going to get this information from. And I'm just going to kind of do it all in one go. Notice the proportion, the fraction is exactly the same. 99 out of 243, 99 out of 243, 99 out of 243, because that's what it should be if there's no difference. Well, then I'm going to look at, okay, what is that times the total number being sold? So there was 84 bottles sold when no music was playing. There were 75 bottles sold when there was French music playing. And there was 84 bottles sold when Italian music was playing. So if I multiply those, I'm going to get the 34.22, the 30.56, and again, 34.22. That's my expected count. Do not round those. Keep those as they are. Now, if I look at the overall proportion for Italian wine, that was 31 out of the 243. And so I'm going to use that one as being constant across all the treatments, because that's saying there's no difference in them. So if I, again, do it all in one go here so we can look at it, if I take it on there, I can see that, yeah, you know what, 31 out of 243, 31 out of 243, 31 out of 243. That's the probability we would expect if it was the same. Now, what changes? What changes is the total type of wines being sold. Well, again, notice there was 84 wine bottles sold when no music was playing. There was 75 when French music was playing, and there was 84 when Italian music was playing. So I'm taking the probability that we're finding, and I multiply by the total from each treatment that we're looking at. So if I look at the other wine, we'll come back up here. If I look at the other wine, 113 out of the 243. 113 out of 243 was other wine. And if there's no difference based off the music playing, whatever that probability is would be constant across all music playing in the background. And that's really what this last one is telling you. This last one is telling you that no matter what music is playing, if the 113 of 243 is the same across it, then if I take the 113 of 243, again, I'm multiplying by 84 because that's the total wine sold when no music was playing. I'm taking the 113 divided by 243, I'm multiplying by 75 because that's the total wine being sold when French music was playing. And again, same thing for Italian. So I'm taking that probability and I'm taking it and distributing it across the columns, these treatments, to find what's going on based off the totals. And that's how we're gonna find our expected counts. So it's a lot of work. So I wonder if we're gonna find a better way of doing this or a quicker way of doing this. And there is a faster way. Let's look at an example, see if there's patterns. 99 of 243 times 84 gave us the 34.22. So keep this in mind, where's 99? Well, 99 was this row total. Where's 84? Well, 84 was this column total. Where's 243? It was this total. So really, it looks like I have a row total times a column total, and then I divide it by the total, the table total. And that is what's gonna give us the overall expected counts for each one. It's a lot faster to do. Now, I went through the different conditions as we went through these here, but notice it's the same idea. I have 99 times 75 over 243. Now, isn't 75 a column total? Isn't 99 a row total? Isn't 243 the table total? Let's see another one. At some point, do I have a 31 over 84, 31 times 84 over 243? And if I look across, I do. I have a 31 times 84 over 243. So this pattern holds to be true, and that is a way to find the expected counts. To find your expected counts, take your row total times your column total, divide by your table total, and that's gonna make the process a lot faster for us. So we just finished calculating all the expected counts, and really what we've done so far is two of the three conditions for calculating a chi-squared statistic. We looked at random assignment for these treatments, so the random condition was met. We looked at the large sample condition. All of our expected counts that we calculated were at least 5, so that's two of the three conditions. But what's the third one? And that's independent. Now in this case, it's an experiment. We can't do the 10% condition because it's not sampling. So when it's an experiment, each treatment has to be independent of one another. Well, that's where it gets a little bit difficult here. Because if a customer goes in and is buying multiple bottles of wine, if they buy a French bottle, that may give us information about the other types of bottles of wine they might purchase. So the condition is violated in that case. But if the other customer goes in there and they only buy one bottle of wine, then the condition is met. So there's a way that the condition is violated and there's a way the condition's met. So what do? We proceed with caution. So we're gonna proceed with caution because it can be met and it can be violated. So we're just gonna proceed with caution. Now the way we calculate our chi-squared statistic is very similar to what you've dealt with before. We're gonna take our observed minus expected, we're gonna square it to make it positive, then divide by the expected, add all those together. But one thing to keep in mind, in this case, we're dealing with a two-way table. So the sum is over all cells. Look at that bottom part right there. The sum is over all cells in the table, in the two-way table. Not the totals though, just all the cells have to be accounted for in our formula. So the chi-squared statistic is gonna be calculated the same way. We just need to make sure every cell is accounted for. So we talked about the hypotheses, we talked about the conditions, and you know what? Let's calculate the chi-squared statistic. So you see my two tables off to the side. The one is the information that was in our two-way table, and the other table on the far right are the expected counts that we found. So calculating this, we're looking at what we observed minus what we expected, square it all over what we expect, add all those together. And you know what? I forget, how many cells do I have to use? Well, I have to use every single cell. Now, when you say every single cell, Mr. Rainsberg, do you mean just the first row? No, I mean every single cell. Oh, so the first two rows. And no, I mean every single cell in the two-way table, not the totals. And so we're going through, you have to use all of those when you're going through. So that's where that nice dot, dot, dot is really useful when we're showing this. So if I look at this, I can go through and say I'm going to have 30 minus the 34.22. We can see how those are related to each other. Square it, divide by the 34.22. That's going to take care of this one. I'm going to have 39 minus 30.56. Square it, divide by the 30.56. That's going to take care of that one. I so don't want to keep doing that over and over and over. So you know what? Dot, dot, dot. I'm gonna do the last one. 35 minus 39.06, square it, divide by 39.06. Well, we're gonna have to calculate all that. Well, here's the good news. We'll probably use our calculator to help us calculate that. However, do show the first two, the dot, 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 and the last one, so you show understanding of the chi-squared statistic formula. Now, I gave you the first two, you get 0.52, 2.33, and the last one is 0.42. Add all those together, I get a chi-squared statistic of 18.28. So what does that mean? So remember, the larger the chi-squared statistic, the more further away you are away from the claim on the chi-squared distribution. The smaller the chi-squared statistic, the closer you are to the claim of the distribution. So we're gonna have to figure this out by going in more detail, maybe finding a p-value to help us out. So overall, what did we just do? Besides finding the p-value and dealing with the conclusion, really what we dealt with so far is calculating a chi-squared test for homogeneity. We actually have walked through most of the performing the test. And we looked at the different conditions, the random, the large sample, and independent. We've talked about those already. We have our null and alternative hypotheses. And the null says there is no difference of the distribution of that categorical variable across the different populations or treatments. The alternative says there is a difference of the distribution of that categorical variable across the different populations or treatments. And we're gonna have a significance level like we're used to. Then we find the expected counts. And we did a lot of work in the beginning, but we learned there was a shortcut to it. And that shortcut says you can take your row total times your column total for each one and divide by the table total. And that's going to give you your expected counts. Then we looked at calculating the chi-squared statistic using that. And we use every cell in the table, but not the totals, every cell in the table using observed minus expected squared divided by expected and adding all those all together. And we learned, man, that dot, dot, dot is a good friend and we can use it. One thing that we did not cover yet, as well as your degrees of freedom, because you remember your chi-square statistic, if you're looking at even table C or even with your calculators, you have to state your degrees of freedom. Well, in this case, since we have this two-way table, we need to take into account the categorical variable and the different populations. So really what we're gonna have is we're gonna have the degrees of freedom is your number of rows minus one times your number of columns minus one. So that's brand new as for us with this, is since we now have a two-way table and we have, you know, multiple populations we're looking at, and this variable distributed across all of them, is how does it perform? Is, well, we need to take that into consideration by doing our number of rows minus one times the number of columns minus one, and that gives us our degrees of freedom. The p-value, still found the same way. Use table C or use your calculator, and it represents the area to the right. So this is really everything we dealt with so far for the most part. And now we're gonna look at an example of this in more detail. So we've been asking the question, does music influence purchases? So let's just finish the whole chi-square test for homogeneity. So state, we wanna perform a test at the alpha equals 0.05 level with the following hypotheses. Now, the null hypothesis says that there is no difference in the distribution of wine purchases at this store when no music, French accordion music, and Italian string music is played. The alternative says that there is a difference in the distribution of wine purchases at this store when no music, French accordion music, or Italian string music is played. So overall, the null says there is no difference in the distributions of insert context. The alternative says there is a difference in the distribution of insert context. That's your state step. The plan step, you still need to state the test that you're going to perform. And we are going to perform a chi-square test for homogeneity. One of the reasons why it's really important here is right now you know goodness of fit, we have homogeneity, and the third one you're going to learn is association and independence. So we have to state which chi-square test we're dealing with. Now, random, you know what? Our treatments were randomly assigned. That's good news. We already calculated all of the expected counts, and all of those are at least five, so that is met as well. And we said when it came to independence, we were unsure that the type of wine being purchased, if they're independent of each other. So what did we decide to do? We decided to proceed with caution. And so that's what we're gonna do as we go into the do step. We will proceed with caution. So we already calculated the chi-squared statistic to be equal to 18.28. Now, I had us just write down the dot, dot, dot stuff, and I told you what the numbers are. We're gonna look at the calculator to help us out in the next example for that. Now, we have to also figure out our degrees of freedom, and that is your number of rows minus one times your number of columns minus one. In that case, I have three rows and I have three columns, so that would be two times two, which is four. We'll look at the calculator, like I said, in the next example. We'll use table C in this example. So I have to go to the row where degrees of freedom is four, and I need to find between what two p-values does 18.28 fall. And if I look at that and I follow row four all the way across, it looks like it falls between 16.42 and 18.47. So that's between 0.001 and 0.0025. So I need to keep that in mind, is that's where our p-value falls between. So if you use table C, you have to state it as it falls between. So I can say right here, the corresponding areas in the right tail of the chi-square distribution with degrees of freedom of four are 0.0025 and 0.001. So that means the p-value based on our sample is between, now a little bit of a correction here, I did forget to put this decimal place, 0.0025 and 0.001. We can use that information to help us with our conclusion step. So now that we know what our p-value is between, we can figure out the rest of the conclusion. Since our p-value is between, here's the next fix, cross this out and put 0.001, I missed the zero. Since our p-value is between 0.0025 and 0.001, we could say that is less than our significance level of 0.05, which means our p-value is less than our alpha, so we are going to reject the null hypothesis and conclude the alternative. Well, what's the alternative? The alternative is that there is a difference in the distributions of wine purchases at the store when no music is played, when French accordion music is played, or when Italian string music is played. Furthermore, our random assignment allows us to say that the difference is caused by the music that is played. So we can go about that way. So overall, we looked at table C. We have to state our p-value as an interval, and we had to find where our chi-square statistic falls between, and we have to state our conclusion, which still follows the same idea. Our p-value is less than our alpha, so we reject the null, and we have enough evidence to conclude the alternative, which for a chi-square test for homogeneity is that there is a difference, insert context. But whoa, let's move on yet, because we have this extension part. Is what would happen if we changed our significance level to 0.01? Would that affect our decision? Well, our p-value is between 0.0025 and 0.001. So even if we changed our alpha level to be 0.01, it would still have the same conclusion in this context. Now, that's a very, I'd say, rare thing, kind of what we've been dealing with before. But do keep in mind that adjusting your significance level can impact your conclusion. So this is kind of just a throwback to what we've studied before to start kind of reviewing some of the concepts. So let's look at another example from beginning to end, state, plan, do, conclude for a chi-square test for homogeneity. So I'm going to read this one fast. Random digit telephone dialing surveys used to exclude cell phone numbers. If the opinions of cell phone people only differ from those who have landlines only, the poll results would not represent the entire population. Oh no! And that Pew Research Center decided to interview separate random samples of cell phone only users and landline only users who are less than 30 years old, and they wanted to ask them, okay, how do you describe your political affiliation? And there's the table of the results. Bam, done. Now, state, we want to test at the alpha equals 0.05 level the following hypotheses. The null hypothesis says that there is no difference in the political party affiliation in the cell phone only users and the landline only users. There is no difference in the political party affiliation based on the type of phone they have. The alternative says there is a difference in the distribution of party affiliation based off of cell phone only or landline only users. So there is our state. State. And so in this case, we have to determine the test, and we're going to perform a chi-square test for homogeneity if these conditions are met. So we have to name the test chi-square test for homogeneity. Random. There were two samples. There was the cell only and there was the landline users. We have to make sure both of them were random, and they were separate random samples of 96 cell only and 104 landline users were used. So the random condition for both of those were met. So keep in mind, two samples, both need to be random. I'm going to skip the large counts for right now so we can pull out the calculator. The independent, keep in mind, between and within, because we're looking at the whole two different samples. So they took independent samples of cell only and landline users. Between, now go within. And so sampling without replacement means we are going to check our 10% condition. And so 10 times 96, it's pretty safe to assume there's more than 960 cell only users under the age of 30, and 10 times 104, it's pretty safe to assume there's more than 1,040 landline users under the age of 30 as well. So these are both safe to assume. Now let's deal with the large counts. And hopefully you can see you have the screen captures from the calculator on there. And so what I need to do is we have to go somewhere a little bit different than what you're used to. Is I'm going to hit my second button, and you can see right here where it's x to the negative first in blue there, it says matrix. We're going to input our table as a matrix in our calculator. So I'm going to hit second, x to the negative first. You can see it highlighted. And I have to go to edit. Names are when you're going to use them in a calculation. Math is when you're trying to perform mathematical operations on them. Edit is when you're trying to create them. So I already have a couple that were created. So I'm just going to choose Matrix A, and I'm gonna hit enter, but make sure I'm on the edit part. So I hit enter, and if I look at the table, we had three rows and we had two columns. And so it's row by column. And I entered in the three rows, and I entered in, enter, two columns, enter. And then I just input all the information that was in my table into Matrix A. So all the numbers there are the same as what's in your table based off the political affiliation. So you can enter those in. So once those are entered in, let's figure out what we do next. Well, it says once they're entered in, we need to go to tests, and we're gonna do a chi-squared test. So it's not the goodness of fit, it's a chi-squared test. So I'm gonna go back to my calculator. I'm gonna hit second mode to get out of this. I'm gonna hit stat, and go over to tests, and I want to choose this time chi-squared test, not chi-squared goodness of fit, chi-squared test, and I'm gonna hit enter. And notice, it's to ask me, hey, where's your observed? I'm putting my observed in Matrix A. It will automatically export the expected counts for you in Matrix B. Thank you, calculator. And I'm gonna either do calculate or draw. So let's just do calculate in this case right now. So I'm gonna calculate it and I'm gonna hit enter. Now what's really nice is take a look. There's my chi-squared statistic, and there's my p-value, and there's my degrees of freedom. That is awesome. However, I do need to show some work when it comes to grading, when it comes to the reader. But I do have all that information there. So if we take a look, that is how I got these right here for my expected counts. Is it exported it into Matrix B for me automatically. And I can see that if I go back to my calculator. If I go back to second, x to the negative first, go to edit and choose Matrix B now. If I enter there, there's all of my expected counts for me. Thank you, calculator. And I can just write those down. And you do need to write those down. Do I really need to write them down? Yes. Are you sure? Yes. Write those down as your expected counts, because you have to prove that all those numbers are greater than or equal to 5. And they are. You have to show that to the grader. So you are going to write that down, and I have that here. So you would write down your table of expected counts, and you would say, guess what? They're all greater than or equal to 5. So my random condition is met, my large sample size is met, and independent is met. So I can now continue on by finding the chi-squared statistic. Well, wait a minute. Didn't that already tell us the chi-squared statistic? Yes, it did. It already told us the chi-squared statistic, which is awesome that it already did that. But I do need to show a little bit of work. Remember, every cell needs to be accounted for. So in the table, we have all the information that was from our cells. We do the first two and then dot, 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 the last one. So that first cell was 49. The expected counts was 46.08, we can see. And so I do 49 minus 46.08, square it, divide by 46.08. The second part was 47, which if you look at that, was 49.92 for the expected. So I'm gonna subtract those, divide, and I go all the way through to the very last one, which has an expected of 32.24. So I work my way through the entire table, but I really just do the first two, dot, 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 the last one. And what's really nice is the calculator found it for me. Now in this case, I have it where I would choose draw instead of calculate, and it drew it for me. It gave me the chi-squared statistic, thank you, because then I don't have to do all of that work by hand. My degrees of freedom, well, maybe the graph didn't tell me, but the calculator did when I went through the first one. It said it was 2. And so I still have that one on my calculator, and I can take a look. If it does tell me, if I go to stat, boom, and I do chi-squared test, and I choose calculate, it tells me the degrees of freedom. The graph one does not, but the graph one does tell me the chi-squared value and the p-value. So I have my degrees of freedom, my p-value is 0.20 around. Well, but now what do I do? Well, I have to decide, do I reject an all or fail to reject an all? Wait a minute, what was my alpha level? Well, my p-value is 0.20, which is greater than my alpha level, which means we fail to reject the null. Well, that means that there is not enough evidence to conclude the alternative. There is not enough evidence to say that there is a difference in the distribution of party affiliation in cell only and landline users in this population. So the calculator, super helpful, because it will find your expected counts, Do I really need to write them down? Yes. Yes, you do. Because you have to show them they're all greater than 5 or equal to 5. You have your chi-square statistic. Do I really need to do every single one? No. Do the first 2, dot, 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 the last one through the table. Let the calculator do the math for you. And the calculator can tell you the degrees of freedom, which isn't too hard math, so you can decide on that one. And it'll do the p-value for you, the exact number, not an interval. Easy to compare to your alpha level. Now, in this case, we failed to reject the null. So let's go to this extension. What does this mean? And what type of error could have occurred if we failed to reject the null? And hopefully you remember, if you fail to reject the null, you might commit a type 2 error. Now, let's talk about a consequence of that type 2 error. And this is pretty interesting. Since there is no difference found, and that's what we had to decide. If, you know, A, we type 2 error is we failed to show that there is a difference. Well, what would happen is those people who are conducting the polls may decide that there is no difference between cell-only users' party affiliation and landline-only users' party affiliation. So they might just decide to do landline users only, which means cell phone users will be completely left out of that survey. And that's not good, because what would happen? Wait a minute, chapter 4, under coverage. Your cell phone users would be under cover. They would not be covered as much. They'd be under coverage with that group because they might decide to only do landline users because, you know, there's a telephone book. It's a lot easier. So there's still a way for us to analyze type 1 error, type 2 error, and consequences. But that's it. So hopefully you understand how to use your calculator to find the expected counts, to help you find the chi-squared statistic. The conclusion is the exact same. The conditions, random and independent, are the same. Large counts, we found the way to use the calculator for. And then we have the differences and what are null and alternative hypotheses. So hopefully this will get you through the first part of lesson 11.2.